gonna play it again. Perfect. Y'all may be seated. Thank you. Your family was bigger than the song. All right, go ahead.
Not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul. Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Sing it with me. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. great thou art.
That's what Brother John's doing right now. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that so exciting? So we're here today to celebrate, grieve as we do, but not without hope. And so we're going to work our way through some scripture this morning. I want to read from the 23rd Psalm, which sort of gives us a little bit of guidance. And we'll have a word of prayer and we'll move on with the service. So y'all know this by heart, but the 23rd Psalm, David, a man after God's own heart, said, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want, I won't lack anything," he says. "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake." It says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Will you go to the Lord in prayer with me? Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for the confidence that we can have, Lord, in eternity, not because of our works or because of Brother John's accomplishments, but because of Jesus. And we thank you for that. We thank you that while we certainly mourn, and certainly there is a shadow associated with death, there's no teeth in it. And so we thank you that we can celebrate and mourn at the same time. And so, Lord, I just pray for his family and friends that as we're gathered here, Lord, there's certainly a mixture of emotions, but we're thankful, Lord, for your presence with us as our shepherd. So help us as we go through these next few minutes together. In Jesus' name, amen. Right. I'm going to read a little bit about him, and then his daughter Lynn is going to come and read for us. So John Henry Ward, 92, of Wellington, passed away Saturday, October 8th, 2022, in Carlsbad, New Mexico. He was born on October 28th, 1929, in Wellington, to William Raymond and Alice May Bruce Ward. He attended school at Chinnery in Wellington and graduated from the Arlington Baptist Seminary. John Henry married Eddie Jo Roberts on February 7th, 1947 in Wellington. She preceded him in death in 1997. He pastored churches in San Saba, Gatesville, Grand Saline, Wellington, and Carlsbad, where he served for 28 years. While in Carlsbad, he was the administrator of Bethel Christian School. He returned to Wellington in 1997 after the death of his wife. John Henry was a member here at the Calvary Baptist Church. He was also preceded in death by his parents, an infant daughter, Deanna Jo Ward, his son, John Wesley Ward, just earlier this year, and daughter-in-law, Claudette Ward, a son-in-law, Lonnie Dunn, and by two sisters, Tommy Watts and Louise Powell. John Henry is survived by three daughters, Joy Weaver and her husband, Jim, of St. Cloud, Minnesota, Lena McMillan and her husband, Britt, and Melissa, Lisa Lewis, and her husband, Jeff, both of Carlsbad. Five sisters, Dolores Patterson, Vera Huntress, and her husband, Tom, Glenna Formani, Adele Burnett, all of Wellington, and Sue Berry, her husband, Jim, and Amarillo, a brother, Bruce Ward, and his wife, Lena, of Wellington, eight grandchildren, 17 great-grandchildren, and five great-great-grandchildren, and about 1,000 other relatives that are here today. And so we're thankful y'all are here. He's a good man. He's a great man. We're looking forward to celebrating his life together. I'm going to have Lena come, if you're still up to it, and say a word for us this morning, okay? Move my things out of your way.
Oh, that daddy of ours. Growing up, Dad would tell us stories about his farming days and riding horses. Oh, that daddy of ours could tell stories so well. We all wanted a horse so bad. We loved all those stories so much, it didn't matter how many times he told them. So that daddy of ours promised, someday we'll get a horse. He was in the seminary when I was born. So he was a preacher for most of our lives. After we were all married and in our own homes, oh, that daddy of ours never forgot his promise. He got Patch from Papa, an angel, an Arabian horse, and gave us each a colt. Once, several of us kids and our families came to visit here in Wellington, and Wesley and Claudia had a nice, good-sized van. Dad drove and was showing us places like where he was born and where Papa was driving a wagon, and Dad was squatted down in front of the seat. And oh, that daddy of ours leaned and grabbed the horse's tail with both hands, and he said, boy, that horse took off. He thought he could grab some of the tail and act like Papa driving with the reins. Then he took us to a little pond where he used to take us swimming when we were little. And oh, that daddy of ours took off across country in that van. When we got back to Papa and Granny's house, one of the tires was going flat. And oh, that daddy of ours said, well, I wonder how that happened. We all got tickled. We knew his teasing. I always got so tickled hearing the story about when Papa, Granny, and family moved south of town. Aunt Louise and oh, that daddy of ours saw Papa standing on the side of the road in the snow, his vehicle broken down. Daddy said we were afraid to stop unless he told us to. And so they went real slow, watching Papa to see if he wanted them to stop. Papa just watched them and never motioned or anything. So they went on by and went home. Oh, that daddy of ours. Granny used to say John Henry would let the kids ride the tractor tires if he thought they could hold on. Oh, that daddy of ours could lay the straightest brick. He watched and taught himself, and he loved to build and remodel houses. Oh, that daddy of ours was pretty handy. I loved riding with him in different areas of Texas. Because, oh, that daddy of ours knew so much history, especially about the Indians. As I drove, he would tell stories of things that happened there or nearby battles. He was just as knowledgeable about the biblical history. And, oh, that daddy of ours could play the harmonica or sing them old cowboy songs, like the one about the cowboy that had never been throwed and the horse that had never been rode. That was one of my favorites, but it was sad. And oh, Strawberry Roam. Oh, how that daddy of ours stood out in a group of preachers with his wavy hair, western suit, and cowboy boots. He was called Daddy and Dad by his kids, Peepaw by his grandkids. But if you wanted his attention, you had to call him Brother Ward. And oh, how we love and will miss that old daddy of ours. I guess I better go this way.
Disoriented up here too. Good. Well, I'm finding I've not pastored for terribly long, but there are two kinds of people. There are those who develop a powerful testimony over their life, and there are those that hope the preacher lies about them after they're gone. So thankful to be in the former here with Brother John. He was a blessing the short time I got to know him. And at a memorial service for a preacher, I'm assuming it would be okay to do just a little bit of preaching, just a little bit. And I know you weren't here to hear me. You're here to celebrate his life. And when I heard that he passed, there's so many things to say about Brother Ward. And in our family devotions this week, we read this passage in Matthew 25, kind of a quality of hospitality is what we were talking about. But I'm going to read a few verses here. And as I was praying about it, so sometimes I think the Lord in his grace gives us very easy things so we don't ruin something that's supposed to be special, because this is really special. And Brother Ward is a hero to many of you and to me. And this was just so easy right here, and he made this very easy. So let me read this for you from Matthew 25. It's kind of a glimpse of a moment in eternity is what this is. It's Jesus giving some instruction about the kingdom, about in heaven. And he says, when the Son of Man, that's Jesus, shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he shall sit upon the throne of his glory. And before him shall be gathered all nations, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he'll set a sheep on the right hand and the goats on the left. And the king shall say to those on the right hand, come ye, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And then he says this, for I was anhungered and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was naked, you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, well, Lord, when did we see you hungry and fed you, or thirsty and gave you drink? When did we see you a stranger and took you in, or naked and clothed you? Or when were you sick or in prison and we came to thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. So at this point in Jesus' ministry, he's already told his disciples that he is the Messiah. They understand that. The kingdom is coming. It will not be fully established until this moment, until his second coming. But until that time, as a church, we have an important mission. We're supposed to be gospel preaching and disciple making and followers of Jesus, regardless of what your particular gift is. As a Christian, those are our marching orders. So really, this time that we have right now is sort of like giving a teenager the keys to the family car. It's a little scary because Jesus is in heaven. He's allowing us to do our work here. It's exciting. There's no one around to micromanage us. And frankly, I'm really not sure that this was a good idea, but God's the one that was in charge. And so he left the church in the hands of humans. And there will one day be a reckoning. And that's what Jesus tells us about here. Now, one could take this passage and assume that if I treat people nice, I will go to heaven. There's a flip side we didn't read, where it's just the opposite side of that coin, where those didn't treat folks a certain way and they're cast into hell. And if you ever talked with Brother Ward about religion, you know that the gospel is a lot more than just how you treat people. We need salvation because we are sinners. And we will face God one day in judgment. The story of Jesus is only one part of that day. The story does show us the kind of heart that God sees that is acceptable, and the kind of person that he hopes to welcome into his kingdom. Now, that makes you nervous. It should make all of us nervous, because none of us are acceptable to God in our own situation, including John Andreas Henry Wadsworth Longfellow Ward. Okay, none of us are good enough on our own. Salvation only comes through the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ. A good person does not somehow get good and get into heaven. That's not how it works. It is only through the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the perfect man, Almighty God in the flesh, the everlasting King. There is no salvation in any other. Now, I'm thankful I don't have to wonder if Brother Ward knew that. We know that he knew that. We know that he believed the right thing. The gospel truth was so worked into his life that it affected everything that he did. It's very evident in his life. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about his life, but his testimony was so worked into this. I think he wrote this song, My Resume. Did he write it, or did he just, because he knew it quite well. And so he's going to one-up Marshall Peters here, because Marshall Peters wrote a poem that I read at his funeral. Brother Ward made a video. I don't know what happens next after this, but I'm going to let you watch this. Hopefully it'll come through okay. If I hit this, I'm going to see if it works. There it is. Yeah. You may need to turn it up a little bit.
Hang on, Dad. Resume. I believe what I do. I believe that Jesus came and gave his life on Calvary for a world of lost sinners. Yes, he died for you and me. And if you will only trust sin. Won't you listen to him, neighbor? Let my blessed Lord come in. Jesus said you must be born again. Paul said only believe. If you'll only take my Savior, a new life you shall receive. He'll sit closer than a brother against all the devil's hosts, and he'll always be near you just when you need him most. Well, I place my faith in Jesus. I'm going to serve him while I can. My soul is in safe keeping. It's in the Lord's Lord hand. I'm not afraid to face tomorrow as I travel down life's road, for I have a friend beside me who'll help me bear my load. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm depending on my Savior. Have I read something?
Pretty clear to me. I think he knew what he believed, don't you think? Absolutely, absolutely. Now, this passage that we read, we understand that your treatment of others does not determine your salvation. So what's the point of this? Your salvation will affect how you treat others. And that was the case with John Henry Ward. There was a day when he trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior, and that changed who he was, and it was evident in his life. You can dress up a certain way, but it doesn't change your heart. But if your heart has changed, you will look a certain way. Does that make sense? I moved to Wellington about 8 years ago, and I would probably fit in that category where he said, I'm not a cowboy, I just found this hat. I think that's a sermon he preached at one point. I'm the furthest thing from a cowboy. My wife tried to make me one. I listened to Riders in the Sky for a week straight and just tried to get into it. She got me boots and a hat and a pair of Wrangler jeans, but the only thing that stuck is I know the words to I've Got Spurs That Jingle, Jangle, Jingle. So that's the only, you know. I didn't even have spurs. John Henry did, and including in church, I've never seen him without a bandana around his neck. He's not a cowboy because he dressed like it. He is a cowboy, right? Jesus tells that a true follower of Jesus is going to demonstrate it in their unflinching, even unreasonable kindness that they show towards everyone. John Henry is in heaven today not because of his works or his successes, but because of his Savior. But we can tell that he was a follower of Jesus because of how he treated people. Those actions didn't earn him heaven. Those actions were the result of him being a child of God. John Henry poured his life into whoever God put in his path. You all are testament to that. I've heard stories all week, and you can continue telling them. But among those recipients were people who Jesus called the least of these. People who according to some, maybe didn't deserve a chance, or maybe you're wasting your time with those people, starting with youth when he was a kid, even I believe it was here, working with his own family. God called him to pastor, not something he expected to do as a cowboy, but he saddled up and got to it, and he lived his life for those that God brought along his way. He pastored here. His name's written in the sidewalk out there. If you haven't seen it as you leave, go look at it. I'm not sure why his name's in the sidewalk, but it's in the sidewalk. No, he did stuff around here. I mean, he built this place. And so one of the things that was constantly told to me was that he found ways to make the Bible come alive. He had stories to make it come alive. You all have told those to me over and over and over, little anecdotes that stuck with you. And he lived that out even after he dismounted the pulpit, and as he continued just living his life, he poured his life into people, particularly the least of these. People, we could almost say he served the least of these almost to a fault. Almost when some would say, hey, you need to cut it out. And yet, just did it. Just showed love towards people. I don't know why my thing's being weird. There we go. So I'll be the first one to admit I get frustrated with people at times. There's those that maybe God places into my life and people God expects me to care for, and my flesh wants to label certain people as undeserving or mooching or workers of the system, and we can justify it or specify it or clarify or falsify or whatever else we try to do. But in the end, what would Jesus do and what would a Christian do? There isn't a soul here that knows about all of the least of these moments that Brother Ward made happen, because he didn't do it for recognition. Probably none of us know all the things that he did for people, because he just did it. He didn't do it and post it to social media, for crying out loud. He'd probably kill somebody if they did, right? It's not, that wasn't what he did. You don't know all the things that he did. John Henry passed away just a few days before the anniversary of another hero named William Tyndale over 480 years ago, and you may not know the name, but if you've ever read the Bible in English, it's because of his work. But William Tyndale had a passion, and he said, "If God spares my life, I will cause a boy that drives the plow to know more of the scripture than you do." He was talking to preachers who were trying to keep the Bible in Latin. They were trying to keep the Bible in a language away from the people. He says, "I want the guy that drives the plow to know the scripture." And his commitment is what allowed us to even have the Word of God in our language today. I bring that up not because John Ward was a Greek or Hebrew scholar, but because he did serious labor translating the Word of God for other people to understand, taking Scripture and working it out from the pulpit in conversations, but even more importantly, in his love towards people. He made God real to people who other people might have just passed by. He's poured his life into those people. And he used cowboy stories and little anecdotes to make it happen. I mean, I wrote down a couple that were mentioned. He said, you've got to put the bucket under the spigot in order to get the water, and you need to be under the blessings of God in order. That's not right out of the Bible, but it's exactly a principle that's right in there. His kids told me about a story when there was gossip going around in the church, and he showed him where he shot his arm and said, "Blood poisoning can kill your body, and this gossip could kill the church." That's hard preaching when it needs to happen, but it made a difference. He used his own life as an illustration, and he demonstrated the selfless love of Jesus. This passage that we read this morning tells me that heaven has heroes. But the heroes in heaven are not just people who have a name here on earth that everybody knows about here on earth. The heroes of heaven are those who showed the love of Jesus to others on earth, to those who were saved and then showed the love of Jesus to other people. There's not a person here, and the reason there's so many here is because you know that John Henry Ward loved Jesus and he loved people. That's what Christians do. He may not have pastored the biggest church around. He may not be known all over the place. He may just be a cowboy preacher, but he loved people, especially the least of these. It's a lesson we can learn from. It's a lesson we can learn from. We get frustrated. I get frustrated with people around. Who have you brushed off in your life? I know I've brushed off some people. Who have you brushed off in your life that say, "Well, that person doesn't have time"? We could ask ourselves, what would Jesus do? But thankfully, God's given us a tangible model, someone a little bit closer to our understanding, and we could say, what would Uncle Bub do? What would he have done? Not for sensation or recognition, but for the purpose of living the life that Jesus saved you for. For John Henry Ward, his work here on earth is done. Jesus' work continues on, and we get to participate in that. So I think it would be a waste of time if we came to remember the life of John Ward and didn't address two very important things, and we're done. Do you have a relationship with Jesus? How you treat people doesn't determine how you get to heaven. Your relationship with Jesus does. And you've heard the gospel. You've heard him sing it. I mean, that's a pretty strong message. If you've never asked Jesus to save you, talk to somebody today about that. I'll be down here. I'd love to talk with you about it. Nail that down. Not for him, but for you and for what Jesus has saved you for. And if you have trusted Christ as your Savior, be wise. Here's a life who's on this side of thing is over, and yet now he is celebrating with his Savior. We've got time still that affects our relationship with other people. How are we treating others? Are we living like Christian? Again, not trying to earn our way into heaven, but loving people because we are Christians. That's what God has called us to. Let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to sing a song together and be dismissed. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the life of Brother Ward. Lord, he's such a a hero to me, and seeing the way that he treated folks, the way that he was, he just loved you in simplicity, but he loved you strongly. He loved you sincerely. And he didn't mind spending his life loving you and loving people and pointing other people to you through salvation. We thank you so much for that. Lord, sometimes we make things way too complicated. And if a preacher cowboy can bring us back to our senses, Lord, I think Brother John's the one to do it, and I thank you so much for that. Lord, now as we celebrate the fact that he is in eternity with you and celebrating with you, we have time on this side of things to get things right, to serve you, to love people. And so, Lord, I pray that you would challenge us to do that. And we just want to pray, continue for his family, Lord, and that you would continue to comfort them and challenge all of us, Lord, in the days ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song together. I think that would be appropriate. It's a happy song. I don't think we'll mind. Let's sing "I'll Fly Away." And I'll just let you be seated as we sing a few verses of this song. And we'll sing "I'll Fly Away." We got it over there. All right. "I'll Fly Away." Here we go.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away. God's celestial shore, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by,